signs for the completion and release of the annual report, our annual report on the human rights situation of the country. For those of you who do not know, the Act establishing the Commission mandates us to submit annual reports on the human rights situation of the country to the heads of the three branches of government. And so, December 2018 has ended. We have a draft report. There are several gaps in our report that we need to verify. We have to check some of the information before we release the report. So, one of the reasons why I came out on the field, we are all over the country right now. Our team, but I led the team on this side because the retreat also coincided with this forum. Also, were bringing me to Kenya. Had I not been for here, I would have been in Lima or Nigeria. So that team as far as we're really trying to review those. And then there are several other things that we're looking at. So while we are here, we're helping the rest of my team, they're all in the field, you know what they're supposed to do. And that's why I'm like this, so forgive my clothes. But it's good to see all of you, and some of you I know, some of you I know by face, but not by name. Some of you I don't know, but during the course of the next 2 days, we will get acquainted with each other. My name is Wilfred, and I'm one of the commissioners at the Independent National Commission on Human Rights. On behalf of the Board of Commissioners and the Secretariat of our commission, we like to welcome all of you. We'd like to extend our heartfelt thanks and appreciation to the Ministry of Justice and several other institutions. I see NIC, I see Ministry of Health, I see several other institutions, I see some businesses, I hear representation from the cross sector of the stakeholders that are very relevant for the business and human rights work here, of course, leading to the development of our national human rights action plan. I'm particularly grateful for the role of the Ministry of Justice. And since Antonia Law, Councilor Williams, who charged me by forcing my answer the rule. Anyway, but the Ministry of Justice, we're so happy as a commission, the Ministry of Justice taking the lead to push business and human rights. I see Odell, one of my group, my sister. And that's what you're hiding from me? And so we're very, very happy because, as you see from some of the discussions we've had today, it is not the Human Rights Commission that leads business and human rights. It's not corporate entities, transnational corporations, or business entities. It is not civil society. I saw Adaman. So Adaman will be so happy that he's here. Civil society has started working with support from Homeville Human Rights and Protection Service, we later on came and joined to push the business and human rights policy. That is what we can do. We can provide the behind support, but it is the government that takes the lead. And the Minister of Justice, and I see with some support from the Minister of Labor, and I see the Bureau of Concession, they're grabbing this thing and running with it, and we're quite excited.
The human rights principles in the country, but our perceiving a reference for the meeting here today, which is on business and human rights. I want to use this opportunity on behalf of the network, Business and Human Rights Network of Liberia, to register our appreciation for the invitation given to our Ministry of Justice and our support from the OOC Sharp office. We want to say, this is a discussion that has started since 2010. And if you are in this room today and just hear about business and human rights, or just in 1 year, We were helped to provide information ranging from 2010 to now where we are. And the level of progress challenge that we have envisaged through all the period will also pass it on to you. But the Commissioner Gray said, when it comes to human rights, it is the government who bear the greater responsibility to ensure the protection, promotion, and respect for every person that enjoys the human rights. So to have seen the Ministry of Justice at this time taking this step, I mean, this is very much welcoming, Councillor. This is welcoming, and we work with the Secretary of the Ministry of Justice Human Rights Commission through all the 2010 to now, where we have been pushing for the cabinet, that is the government, to be able to have an ear and how the government can accept the business and human rights principle to be what they use, so that corporate entity, business entity will also help to contribute to the promotion and protection of human rights in Nigeria. For your information, let me just register that business agents in the public sector is the biggest employment sector. Government, yes, we accept. But if you can have businesses, corporate entities, to be able to help in the promotion and protection of human rights, I think we'll have a good society, we'll have a country that will be growing very fast. I remember that the challenges in concession areas that relate to labor issues, we monitor most of them, and the land is there. We will follow them later on during our presentation. So we thought that this is the human rights principle, the concept. Once it is accepted, pushed by the government, then of course we'll be moving in a more better way when it comes to promoting and improving human rights on the ground. So from the level of civil society, we remain committed and to push the governance process of the country. And you can also please call on us, Ministry of Justice. They are good expertise when it comes to business and human rights. The different principles, the guiding principles that govern the business and human rights processes, you can call us and review the work group to ensure that a fair place is given to this whole concept, and of course to be able to improve businesses, operation on the ground, and then the society, the community that operates, so that we can be able to reduce violations and abuses when it comes to human rights in the country. Again, I'm part of this participating team, so we can discuss in the certain environment.
However, without our protection, we can do just anything. And just say, Councilor Trump says so. However, just remember that fact, very well they said, not go below that much. On behalf of the Minister of Justice, Honorable Frank Musati, who would have loved to be here, but due to personal engagement, I bring you warm greetings and facilitation on behalf of my chief and wish you well in your deliberation as you pursue this exercise. Please rest assured that we are by your side, we're in front of you, we're behind you. We'll do all and everything as humanly possible when it's legal, it's legitimate, it does not defy public policy. So on that note, so wish you well and congratulations. Thank you.
To work towards having the government take the lead on this initiative. And thanks to Honorable Minister that he has seen the purpose reason for the ministry to take the lead. For us, we are willing and ready to support the government in this direction. And I speak on behalf of my chief that business and human rights is a very cardinal issue around the world today. And Liberia being what we call a fresh nation in terms of investment, it is time we take the bull by the horn. Because by the time we reach to the investment climate that is very rigid, if we don't have the necessary mechanism in place, Liberia
will face the difficulty that other nations are now fighting to do against. So I want to also thank the minister for allowing us, because he asked us to invite some civil society as observers. Again, the civil society are here as observers. This is a government driven initiative, and this is a government sitting. We hope at the end of this sitting, we will have a well organized, well laid out plan that a working team will be ready to work. That's why you see, so they say your country is not business friendly. You have some of your laws, it was not master of national setup. So it has a responsibility. If you are a business, a working in a country that has huge human rights abuses or human rights violation, the business can be held responsible. Are we there? In Liberia, we have a clear example of businesses being held responsible for violation of human rights. You know, just recent past, there was a businessman that grew up called Boss. Right? He was held responsible for situation in Liberia when he was never a fighter. When his business was actually operating at the time that Liberia was being accused of some violation. So he too was connected to the violation. Globalization. The whole human rights in business issue we are discussing is about globalization. It's not tied to only Liberia. I'll show a picture of it. That picture is from one of the companies around Liberia. And there's a pollution from the company into the water. And you know how many persons survive in that water? They have down the water or up the water. Business and human rights cannot provide unprecedented opportunities to companies and businesses. While if you have good business and human rights record, you will have good partners, you will have good employees, you will have good opportunities. Greater reach and activities. If your business or your entity is a good entity, you have a wider space to invest. Remember, some people say, oh, our company is our place because of the record that you have laid. Increase profit, power, and influence. Increase profit, power, and influence. If you have a good business practice, if you have a good business practice, the first thing you will do is that you have power. Why will your business have power? Have you seen businesses dictate to government? If you don't go this way, you will pull out. Right? So you will have influence on the day-to-day activity, and most of all the people are for you, then they make it worse. Challenges to state sovereignty. A good human rights policy, a good institution can challenge state sovereignty. Wow, independent nation, I can do that, I can do all that, I can do all my investment. The other the sovereignty of an independent nation, I'm going to tell you what you're negotiating, but if such a country, the economy can be effective. It has a great impact on investment, employment, environment, and human rights. Of course, you can see the impact on environment right there. Just that simple pollution of our water is a serious environmental crisis warning, both short term and long term. Investment, of course, we know. Good business can boost the nation economy. And then, employment, of course. If your business is a good entity, it can attract professional people. Everybody wants to work with you. You say, yeah, we have a good policy, we have a good system of working. But of course, the environment, it can affect the environment positively and negatively. And then, human rights, of course, we should talk about human rights, of course. We know that they will have a huge impact on human rights. The life of the people. Demands for taking responsibility and being held more effectively to account for private sector human rights impact. The demand on companies is now getting greater and greater. If you want to ask me a question, I'm going to find it, but I'm going to see if there's something that can break me outside. But all that gaps. Gaps is the key part of the economic forces from investment and the capacity of government to manage their human rights consequences. There's a gap. Because some businesses are marketing businesses, and your government depends on these businesses to operate. So if the businesses are violating human rights, sometimes it becomes a problem for the government to respond. Because the government depends on that investment. Are we there? Yeah. So that is why the pressures from businesses to spend human rights, because there's a big gap between the power of the businesses and the power of the government. Investment, environment, and this inadequate respect and remembering application of human rights, similar policy practices like companies. Investment, environment. The way the government allows businesses to operate, sometimes allow businesses to do the kind of things they do. If you don't have a policy in place that businesses maybe have to go to the NRC, go to the different entities to register, if somebody in that kind of the entire system, they jump in, of course you're going to buy a respect system. Because the environment for investment is not transparent. And it's no secret that some of us know out here that some kind of our system allow business and human rights is also affected. And they say, oh, you know, I'm trying to be real practical about the United Nations. This year, has this problem when it comes to business and human rights. The way they make the rule from the international standard sometimes affect the way government respond to businesses. So it's both structure, the way the rules are structured. Due to competitive dynamics. Right now in the world, there's huge competition for businesses' survival. One company making billions of dollars and want to own everybody. Home country is reluctant to regulate companies because they are focused on promoting their own businesses. And most countries concerned about losing investment and weak competition also, poor implementation of regulation. So you see the difference is, the Chinese company, if they come to your country, for example, and are causing human rights violation, by right, it is the Chinese government that should act on that company, because the company is the Chinese company. But maybe because the Chinese people want their investment all over the world, they might not act the way they want to act. And because your country do not want to lose the cash, your country will not respond the way people respond. So the businesses themselves, the pressure is on them to respect morals because of these imbalances. Due to policy incoherence, weak governance, or compartmentalized approach. Of course, we know weak governance. If the government is not governing well, businesses will take advantage. Let's give an example of it. And then we talk about compartmentalized approach. Businesses are not of the same class, are not of the same standard. There are multi-million dollar companies, there are smaller companies, but you address everybody in one cluster. Of course, who will win? The more money. Right? If you don't have a policy that will deal with businesses based on their standard and their capacity, you put everybody in one basket, the only person that will jump on the basket will be the strongest chief. Right? Challenges at international domestic level. Limited accountability and voluntarism. Limited accountability by most countries due to bad governance, including high level of corruption. These are challenges. Something to tell you why. Thank you. These are the reasons why businesses have to deal with ignorance. Because of all the examples we put here, this is why businesses have direct responsibility for human rights. So now we understand human rights. Now we understand why businesses don't respect human rights. But there are challenges that are beyond government mission. And now we know why government should take the place of human rights serious. And I put some pictures there for you to see.
I know you landscape, of course, enjoying the government in so much is good. But for business institution, for business institution, it also helps to promote them too. Because if you help in the promotion and protection for human rights, adherence to business and human rights principles, it gives you a level of trust. And, you know, people will have confidence in your business entity, your company. And of course, you could be a water for good human rights practices that you carry on as a company, and you could see yourself being elevated to a more stronger position in terms of applying and seeing business and human rights, you know, being of help at your company level. So it's something good that will also help the businesses to boom, you know, to have more investment and then more interest of people wanting to work with them. So it's a two-way thing.
Sorry that you need to be my class guy for our college. I ain't know my own here that for a long time. Okay, my concern has to do with business and the environment. Thank you for your presentation. I saw the
sorry, issue now, that I'm saying when you speak, Councillor, please call your name. Put your name and listen to me.
Okay, I'm Councillor Edwin Yelwoods. I'm from the Environmental Protection Agency. Your discussion and presentation draw me to give a little on business in the environment. The issue of pollution, the issue of environmental degradation. Business people are very liable for that. I can give you a case study on the Ghana Chow Bag at the Bono Bag. The Ghana Chow Bag, Liberia is part of the Ramsar Conventions to protect the wetland. We stopping environmental protection agencies stopping from being in the wetland. We force it to build it. That place is sinking. It does not even have a separate thing. All the feces there go in the stream there. We carry our cars there. The children wash our cars with the same. Yeah. So the issue of government coming protecting businesses, business people too, are the cause of pollution. So you cannot hold government liable when it comes to that aspect of the human right. Because government will tell you that this place is a protected area. Do not build in the wetland. Our business people will still go and build there. So how do you expect government to protect businesses? That's my question.
National Bureau of Protection. I want to thank our presenter for the presentation. I think it was good enough. The point I want to make here is on the issue of compliance. You know, we expect the businesses to comply with the basic tenets of human rights. For many of the concession agreements, you read them, you will see some tenets of human rights. It's not very clear to say this particular clause pertains to human rights. So what that means is that this kind of workshop should be held in a way so that those that are preparing the instruments for concession, for example, the concession agreements, should be fully aware so that they can include those clauses within the concession agreement. Now, you will not be able to hold as a nation a business, a particular business, liable for certain action, except maybe on a collateral basis. The person gets a damage cause, and you say, okay, we'll hold you. But respect to compliance, they can always find an excuse. So this is not part of the agreement we signed. So it becomes the responsibility of the government to deal with the collateral that the non-compliance will cost. So we need to start looking at the instruments. What are the human rights instruments that are enshrined within the concession agreement or within the business agreement that we sign? If a business entity comes to NIC, do they talk about human rights issues at the NIC when they're conceptualizing the business, or do they just talk about the business proposal, the income they will bring, the employment they will bring? So I just thought that we need to begin to highlight the instruments that are needed to ensure that we have compliance.
Eternal Afua, of course, you know she was not Minister of Justice by then. So she came from the OIC group that's a forum that was as a private consultant that was held in France, in Paris, and she was invited to speak at that conference. And I was happy that I was there to see my former minister and one of my good friends, you know, a woman who got a lot of respect for, speak to that conference. And one of the things she was looking at was the extent to which corporations or governments turn a blind eye in terms of show due diligence before granting concessions, or at least ensure compliance before getting concession. And they were considering the broader indicators she came from a post-conflict context. So if you look at Liberia emerging from civil war by 2006 and 2007, Metastasis era are coming in. I'm not giving excuse for the government, it's just some practical realities. And the Bureau of Concession or NIC, the government, the Ministry of Justice, will have to do thorough due diligence on everything that's required before granting concession agreements. When people are under pressure for some jobs to do, there needs to be some quick resources in the economy to provide basic healthcare services and education. Sometimes it's difficult to think much of the long-ranging consequences. And so Christian Kahn will want to question what were your processes of due diligence for the companies during those days as opposed to the country. Of course, they will not be the same if you look at the context right now. And then there's a third one in terms of fulfilled. How do we take the appropriate legislative, administrative, and budgetary side of our protection is very valuable? It's not the only one in the government. But the way to connect with this. So how do we ensure that we are taking the appropriate administrative and legislative, budgetary, judicial, and other measures that will facilitate access to human rights? So therefore, let's come on. What then are the human guiding principles? I mean, you have it, so you have these principles. Now, as a result of the framework to respect or to promote respect and remedy or to fulfill, in 2011, mind the first one 2008, by 2011, the United Nations came up now with an endorsement of the United Nations, what they call the United Nations guiding principles on basis of human rights. Now you can see guiding principles, a set of, how you call it, is a set of guidelines, mechanisms, procedures to guide member states in terms of how you can achieve the 2008 framework, but how you can then work more in your country to ensure that you can achieve these guiding principles on basis of human rights. So the guiding principles expose foundations, it exposes foundations of duties and responsibilities to prevent and redress violations acting for businesses. But let me just add something that one of them, so that's our it is meaning a framework that is authoritative. It's an authoritative global framework on business and morals. Basically, that's what the guiding principles are. And we look at what the guiding principles are when I jump over right here to this slide. Now, the whole process, let me make it a little bit of the screen. So there's the United Nations Central Representative to the United Nations, and we never point out to the link of the Esplanade or the kind of money with these guys. So, and one of the things to do with the tax break, so this guy, people were saying, To all the billionaires, don't give us charity. Please, don't give us charity. Just pay your fair price. And I will say in my presentation, if we will achieve the Millennium Development Goals, especially to raise the money, let's make our businesses in Liberia pay fair taxes. Now, will you know it? Because they pay the fair taxes, Africa will get billions of dollars. States will get billions of dollars. When we develop the PRS in 2000, the poverty reduction strategy in 2008, I said, we consider the PRS. The costing chapter 8 of the PRS, the poverty reduction strategy in 2008, it projected that to implement the PRS for 3 years, the government costed the PRS as six, $3 billion. $3.1 billion to implement the PRS for 3 years, 2009, 2010, 2011. When we did the costing, the analysis, government, in that CPRS state, the government only mobilized for domestic resources in 3 years. That was 2008. In 3 years, 510 million. Leaving a funding gap of around, a little more than $1 billion. But when you go back and look at the extractive industries and the money that was getting out of Liberia, even for the maritime programs and everything else, if there were taxes spent for the 3 years, commensurate, and all of this something is commensurate, for the 3 years, as though someone were coming, Liberia should have raised $4 billion. So Liberia could have gotten all the money we needed to implement the poverty reduction strategy. But the country said we can only raise 510 million in 3 years from domestic revenue. But these are issues related to racism and human rights. Like Gavin said, this is more of an eye opener. Some of these things we're not addressing yet. We're not addressing maybe in our lifetime. But these are serious, serious issues related to racism and human rights. Let me take two more questions from you at home. I beg you. But the 21st century has been riddled, if you will, with the view that the issue of human rights can no longer be discussed only from state actors' perspective. There are activities that the states have got absolutely no connection with that are still violating or abusing in a word of conventional way. It's a matter of semantics, whether you violate or you abuse or that is the same thing. Whether you do not swallow the fish or the fish swallow the man, someone is being hurt. Someone is being hurt, and that's what I'm here for. Not here to look at the definition of violation or abuse. It's not illegal, not looking at illegal content, looking at the context that someone has a right and that right has been temporal. So, the UN, as you know, sets standards. The UN has a specific mandate to deal with issues surrounding human rights and how institutions should be held accountable for the violations of these rights. So therefore, the issue of human rights no longer was limited to only state actors. It became wide enough to cover the private sector because it has been observed, as you shall see, that state actors, business actors now, or private sector, were also involved in a violation or abuse of what constitutes human rights violation or abuse. Issues such as the pollution of save drinking water by communities, which led, in the case of Liberia, to the hospitalization of over 20 people. You all know the story. There's been bad business practices all over the world. Liberia is not unique. But in the case of Liberia, we have a situation where, you know, people polluted the water, whether advertently or inadvertently, with cyanide. And you know what cyanide? The power of that chemical. Additional small scale miners are using mercury in the environment to collect an environmental impact that has created. Gender issues in workplace. Why females are treated different from males. These are not violations that, in my view, can be the responsibility of government. Government sits somewhere, government, in some cases of that, no idea on the violation or the practices that go on. Businesses come for one major thing, and let us make it clear, profit making, right? In the process of making profit, sometimes they have used the Machiavelli approach, where the end justifies the means. At whatever means you can get to make my profit, make my profit. Sometimes it comes at the cost of the lives of these employees, right? Someone said, if you see the bigger company that does, then this is a joke, don't take it from me. Is it a company that can do rubber bidding when you see a latest coming in, a big something, you better go from the road, you know? But the point I'm making is, businesses are so vicious in the process of making profit, to the extent that sometimes they do not have the cost of how they violate the rights of the very people that help them maximize profit. And of course, it cannot be them alone. And Commissioner Graves has talked about it in the guiding principle, that there are two major stakeholders here. You know, the tier one is usually the victim, so the employees in the community are usually the victims. But you have government responsibility to protect the rights of its citizens. And you have the corporate actors' responsibility to promote human rights at a bare minimum. That's what you should be doing. We will promote as well, but we more about protecting these by instituting, you know, instruments such as, you know, frameworks and guiding principles and so forth, and regulations and so forth. But these concessionaires also have responsibility to ensure that without even regulating them, they come with some level of responsibility to ensure